This elm tree is 300 years old. It's the oldest tree in Manhattan. And in its lifetime, it's captured 9 tons of carbon. My carbon footprint last year was about 16 tons of carbon. So if this 300-year-old elm tree can't even sequester 1 year of my carbon footprint, is it really worth it to plant a ton of trees to reverse climate change? Trees. They regularly make headlines as a savior for climate change, whether it's articles arguing that planting 1 trillion trees could sequester all our carbon emissions, or YouTubers raising money to plant over 20 million trees, there is no shortage of news about the potential salvation trees can provide. But is planting trees all it's cracked up to be? Or is this an overblown promise to generate headlines and unrealistic hope? To find out, I'm gonna talk to experts with different perspectives on this question to understand, can planting trees reverse the climate crisis? I'm Lucy Biggers, and this is One Small Step. The carbon capture promise of trees is simple biology. During photosynthesis, trees take CO2 out of the atmosphere and use carbon to build their branches, leaves, and roots. This is made out of carbon. Then the trees release oxygen. And as we all know, because of human activity and the burning of fossil fuels, there is too much CO2 in our atmosphere and it's heating up our planet. So it's quite logical that planting more CO2-sucking trees could balance out our carbon balance sheet. And forests are already doing this for us. Annually, US forest lands sequester about 14% of our economy-wide carbon emissions. Even though there's a ton of hype around tree planting, deforestation hasn't stopped. Just ask Professor Myron Dewey of the Walker River Paiute Tribe.
Myron Dewey. My name is Myron Dewey, and my Paiute name is Strong Thinker.
Myron Dewey is a professor, filmmaker, and founder of Digital Smoke Signals, an Indigenous community journalism and social media platform. Myron has used his drone to document the deforestation of the sacred Tababe pine nut forest near his reservation in western Nevada since 2013. These forests are now on U.S. public lands and managed by the U.S. Forest Service, which has clear-cut several areas over the last decade. The forests that have been cut down are part of the historic sacred harvesting sites of the Paiute Shoshone tribes.
The pine nut tree has a lot of significance, not just to our Paiute, Shoshone, and Washoe relatives as shared traditional resources, but also with the ecosystem all around it, the wind, the natural law, the real basic things. The moisture in the air, those trees hold moisture. We're seeing the change from not just the land, but the wildland fires and the precipitation in those areas, the snowfall in those areas. There's a lot changing. The birds aren't coming back in certain areas.
Using Google Earth time-lapse, you can see from 2006 to 2018, there's been a significant proportion of deforestation that's happened in this area.
So we're looking at something that feeds the birds, the different animals that come through when they hit the ground. We have ceremonies around it. We have baskets, willow baskets, that clean the pine nuts. We have pine nut soup. Pine nuts are used all over the United States and the world in salads. Americans are eating our traditional foods, but we still harvest them. When we go out and we manage the land, we acknowledge the land, we acknowledge our ancestors prior to us in those areas. That's why we know when this is, we come back to an area and it's a harvesting area and it's gone. It's devastating spiritually, mentally, physically. Now that we have a Native American and the Department of Interior overseeing these public lands, it's gonna be real interesting to see, will we have a say over our own traditional harvesting areas now? I think that the indigenous people, the elders that we have, would like to see some well-being come back into the community. But we've got so many fights, we don't get to be a part of that discussion. And then to say, no, that's not good. Yes, that's good. And that's what we're struggling with.
Myron's experience highlights the importance of consulting with Indigenous communities before undertaking a project like planting a trillion trees. And even if those trees were planted tomorrow, it would take decades for a pine nut tree to reach maturity. In addition to the significant cultural and historical heritage that's lost when these trees are cut down, research has shown intact forests sequester more carbon than planting new trees. So the first and most important step is decreasing deforestation and protecting existing forests. But even if we stop cutting forests down tomorrow, there are still forest fires, and they're getting more extreme. By one estimate, an average of 7 million acres of forests burn in wildfires in the U.S. each year. That's an area larger than the state of Massachusetts. So what's the best way to replace the forests we're losing?
We need something that is able to address that reforestation debt and that backlog, and we need something that's able to be fast.
That's Grant Canary, the founder of DroneSeed, a startup that uses drones to spread tree seeds and reforest land devastated by wildfires. They also took part in the recent high-profile Team Trees program.
And why can't we just leave the forests alone? How do we know that we're not doing more harm than good by putting the seeds in there when, you know, forests are an ecosystem that knows how to recover from a fire?
What we see is 7 million acres burn. Our maximum capacity to grow seedlings is maybe 3, maybe 4 million acres, best case. That's if everybody is at 100%. So 7 minus 4, we got 3 million acres that nature has to take care of. Now, fast forward 10 years, we're seeing more and more moderate to high severity fires. That 10-year rolling average is 10 million, 15 million. If our capacity is still at 3 million, we're headed to a future where places like California first to have no forests, then Oregon, then Washington, et cetera. We're not against nurseries. Absolutely do the nurseries, but that's a 2 to 3 year backlog. Let's get out there in 30 to 90 days. That's what DroneSeed does.
Grant's drones go out over areas hard to reach by humans and disperse a polyculture mix of seeds native to the selected region.
It goes beyond native. We want polyculture so that it's multiple species because that's more fire resilient. Well, like, isn't that amazing? And like, that's also an opportunity to have much more diverse ecosystems.
The seeds are covered in hot chili powder so that rodents don't eat them. They say their method is 6 times faster than the conventional reforestation projects and can drop millions of seeds at a time. While Grant's method is scale and seed, some organizations are focusing on more local solutions.
You start with the communities and what they want, your trees are more likely to survive and more likely to make an impact on climate.
Instead of millions of seeds at a time, Sebastian Africano and his organization, Trees, Water, and People, plant 150,000 seedling trees across Central America, the U.S., and Native nations per year.
Why is it so important to make that connection with the local community and have buy-in from them?
It's their land and it's their landscape, and they're the stewards of that land. So if you have their buy-in and the trees are going to produce a future value for them or their community or for future generations, the trees are more likely to survive.
Sebastian told me that on average, seedlings have a 1 in 4 chance of surviving to be mature trees.
There's a lot more to how and why a tree is planted than just the act of getting a tree in the ground. The best time to plant a tree was yesterday, right? I still believe that there's a deficit and planting trees is generally a good thing. I think forest management is very different than planting trees. So like over the past 100 years, how we haven't been harvesting or haven't been thinning forests, you end up with high density plantings of one type of species that are more prone to disease and more prone to fires 100 years down the line.
As people who have made it their mission to plant more trees, I was curious if Sebastian or Grant believe that trees could reverse climate change.
Absolutely not. That's like saying there's a silver bullet. There's a silver bullet to climate change. If we just planted trees, everything would be great. DroneSeed, what we focus on is we want to mitigate climate change. There's no like solving climate change. There seems to be this idea that there, that like we have to pick one and just everyone gets behind that. We need all solutions on the table.
I think it's ambitious. I think that trees have the best chance of surviving if they're planted to meet human needs, and that's what we focus on. So when a community is engaged and invested in that tree and how it grows and what it's going to be grown for and what it's going to produce in terms of economic value, food value, or just soil value, watershed value, cultural value, that tree is going to stand a much higher chance of surviving. We have to be careful with the big pronouncements because there's so many variables working against trees. And there's also human preference and land use and land use choices.
So is planting a trillion trees a silver bullet that will stop the climate crisis? Definitely not. First off, the most effective step is to protect existing forests. As Myron explained, these forests provide more than just carbon sequestration. They're part of an ecological history and culture that we'll lose if they're gone. I do think planting more trees can help us get toward our climate goals, but that undertaking requires deliberate care and consideration and should involve local stakeholders. Part of me is concerned that the rush and enthusiasm to plant millions of trees could create unforeseen issues later down the road. Planting trees shouldn't be a replacement for climate policy and decarbonizing our economy. Still, I think it's a positive sign that we're even talking about trees in the first place. It shows that as a society, we're trying to heal our planet and reverse the damage that we've done. So my one small step is plant trees responsibly. Whether you're sprucing up your backyard or donating money to tree planting organizations, having more trees is a good thing. Just make sure you do your research. That's all for this episode. See you next time. Bye.
Just finished up filming in Washington Square Park on a chilly day. Nothing like talking about trees when there are no leaves on them.